real city. Is everybody ready to go? It's proclaimed the greatest radio show.
Welcome, fans, to another episode of The Spread. I'm your host, Jim Sella, in studio with co-host Jay Dash. Going to talk some more fantasy football players for you. We just did the first segment, players 1 through 25. Now we're going to do players 26 through 50.
Please believe. Let's get this started here because the last segment went a little longer than I expected, and I want them to get a little bit quicker as we go along.
We ramble like a woman. I don't know what to do. No offense, ladies.
All right, let's move on to number 26 here. Drew Brees, quarterback of the New Orleans Saints. He had a huge season last year, 4,952 yards passing with 33 touchdowns, although he was inconsistent and he threw 17 picks during the season. But he still had 10 multi-TD games and at least one TD in all 16 games. He had three or more TDs five times, including five touchdowns versus Pittsburgh. He had eight 300-yard games, including 420 yards versus Baltimore. He had 32 or more attempts in 15 games and no less than 27 attempts in any game. And he had 40 or more attempts 10 times. Now, here's the thing. He lost Jimmy Graham. He lost Kenny Stills. Colston isn't the same receiver he used to be. And then you got Brandon Cooks, who looks like it's going to be their number one receiver out there. Drew Brees
was
a little...
They lost some O-line help, too.
Yeah, I mean, New Orleans is definitely getting worse this season. Now, Drew Brees is still one of the best quarterbacks to own in fantasy, but is he worth a second-round pick? I don't think so. I'm waiting until the third round, at least, on this guy. Although, I am going to take him over guys like Peyton Manning still. Peyton Manning's going to take a step back this season as well, I believe. And then you got guys like Russell Wilson and Big Ben. So, I'm still sticking with Drew Brees as one of my top quarterbacks. I'm just... going with other positions first. I'm going to let the quarterback drop a little longer. And you're probably going to go into your draft. If you're going to draft him at number 26 like I am, he's probably going to be gone. Somebody's going to overdraft him, but I'm not going to be that guy.
No, I think the Saints, the whole team, take a step back this year. I think the offense takes a step back. It's not saying Brees isn't going to put up some points, but I don't know. I feel like he may be nearing the end of his dominance as far as even stats go. And
well, it depends on where you're sitting.
Quarterback,
do you have
later.
Two wide receivers? Do you have your running backs? It depends on what you have going.
Even then, man, I might try for that because, like I said in the first segment, you can find quarterbacks easier. If you're in a 12-team league, there's 32 starting quarterbacks. Not a whole lot of people are smart enough to carry the extra good quarterback, or they just don't want to, or whatever. So, I mean, you're really only looking at 11 other quarterbacks being taken other than your guy.
You said something about Mike Evans. I have him here at number 27. The reason I'm taking Drew Brees over him, I trust him just a little bit more right now. Why? Mike Evans could be a number 3 receiver by the end of the season. But he could also do nothing. It all depends on what Jameis Winston does this season. Is Winston going to be able to get him the ball like they did last season? You look, I mean, he had 68 receptions last year, but he had 124 targets. So they had problems getting him the ball last season.
Josh McCown was terrible in Tampa Bay last year.
Yeah, is Jameis Winston going to be better?
Yes.
I hope so. I would believe so. But there is no guarantee that him and Mike Evans are going to have a good chemistry from the beginning, or if they even get it at all this season. Who knows? I still like Mike Evans. I'm still going to take him pretty early. A lot of people have Mike Evans real high. They have him early second-round pick. I'm not going to trust him that high. I'm
not
gonna
with the
wait.
Shaky quarterback
yeah,
situation.
Exactly. But, I mean, you look, last year he was dominant. Three 100-yard games, including 209 yards at Washington. He had 55 yards or less 10 times, though. So you can see the inconsistencies. Now you got a new quarterback coming in. Those inconsistencies could show up again this season. And he had more than 5 receptions just 3 times. So you can see he wasn't completely dominating. But usually in a guy's second year, he does get better. But Is it going to be the right situation this season? It's a question mark, so he's not a second-round pick for me. I'm waiting till the third round for this guy, but he's still a top 15 wide receiver in fantasy.
He's a big guy who can make big plays, and Winston has a big arm, so there is definitely still the opportunity for him to put up points, maybe even more than last year. But I do understand why you're hesitant to take him in the first two rounds with his bout with inconsistencies last year. But remember, Josh McCown only had 1 touchdown and 10 picks, so it's not like he had anybody throwing him the football.
Correct. But, I'm never sold on a quarterback coming in his rookie season.
I know, I agree. So. I just think that Winston's got to be better than what McCown and Glennon gave them last year. I really it can't be much worse.
I agree. And Mike Evans, if he is a little bit better because of Jameis Winston, this pick will be worth it. Now, if you take him at the top of the second round and he's just a little bit better, then that pick wasn't worth it. But if Jameis Winston blows up, Mike Evans could be a top five wide receiver in the end. So you could be getting a good deal here. And this is a fantasy sleeper somewhat. I mean, a 27th pick, you really can't say it's a sleeper, but he could be a lot better than pick 27.
Keep sleeping on him. Nobody's sleeping on our next guy.
Pick 28, Peyton Manning of the Denver Broncos. Fourth quarterback in the fantasy rankings here. 4,727 yards last season with 39 touchdowns and 15 picks. He had 7 300-yard games, 2 400-yard games, almost a 500-yard game versus Arizona. He had 12 multi-TD games. He had 8 games with 3 or more TDs, 5 touchdowns at Oakland, and 3 4-TD games. He had 33 or more attempts 12 times, but he had just 3 TDs with 6 interceptions over his final 4 games of the season. Julius Thomas is gone, so that doesn't bode well for Peyton Manning, but he still has Demaryius Thomas, Emmanuel Sanders out there. He has a beast running back in C.J. Anderson. He's still going to be a good quarterback for you. He's just not the number one quarterback anymore.
Now, he was battling, it was either quad or hamstring injuries, I can't remember for sure, at the end of last season. And like you said, Thomas is gone. But I think Peyton's efficiency will be better this year. He'll throw a little less. He'll probably throw for a little less yards. But it wouldn't surprise me to see him throw 45 touchdowns and only like 8 to 12 picks, or maybe
that'd
even
be a huge season
6 to 10 picks.
If he does that, you better pick him in the second round.
Gary
son.
Kubiak is going to use him the right way. I think the offense relied too much on Peyton last year instead of just letting him be as good as he could be and then letting the other playmakers do what they needed to do.
Another reason you got to wait to the third round here to draft him is just because of the injury concerns, too. Is he going to be able to last a full season? It is worth the chance, though, here in the third round, I believe.
He's always screwed me in December.
All right. 29th, Mark Ingram, our 11th running back out of New Orleans.
Hey, New Orleans is going to give somebody the ball on offense. It's either going to be Cooks or Ingram.
Yeah, and Ingram should see an increase in carries this season. He only played in 13 games last season and still came up with 964 yards and 9 rushing touchdowns. He was used in the passing game, 29 receptions for 145 yards, although he didn't get in the end zone through the air. But he had 4 100-yard games, including 172 versus Green Bay. He had 60 yards or less 7 times, though, so he had a little bit of inconsistencies, and that's something you're going to have to deal with in New Orleans, especially at the running back position.
It's going
to
be a rocky season for Saints fans.
Please believe. But, I mean, you look around, man, there aren't many good running backs that you can completely rely on in fantasy here, and this is going to be one of those guys like a Jeremy Hill. You weren't so sure if you can trust him 100%. These are the kind of guys you're going to have to draft just to fill out your roster this season. This isn't the same fantasy football we used to see back in the day.
Yeah, running backs do not get as many points as they used to, and wide receivers are tough. They have to catch the ball to get any points, and if you have a garbage quarterback, you can't catch the ball, or if you just have stone hands, you can't catch the ball.
Well, here's the thing, man. Back in the day, there used to be feature running backs for all 32 teams.
Oh, yeah. No, 5 teams probably have a feature running back now.
And that's the guys you want to draft. And if you don't get them, you're going to end up with guys like Mark Ingram, who have C.J. Spiller behind him, Kerry Robinson behind him, Tim Hightower behind him. So those guys are going to see a lot of time as well. Mark Ingram should be the best running back out of that group, but he is not a feature back.
Saints have always been running back by committee, so it's scary.
All right, let's move on to number 30 here. Wide receiver for Carolina, Kelvin Benjamin, a guy I really like.
He's going to have a big year.
I think so, too. Look, he had 73 receptions last year, which is very good for a rookie, but he had 146 targets. So if Cam Newton has any more time to throw this season, right, Kelvin Benjamin's going to have a lot better season. He still had 1,008 yards and 9 touchdowns. He had a 2 TD game at Seattle in the playoffs, so he was playing well late in the season. He had 5 or more receptions 8 times, 10 or more targets 7 times, 4 times in his final 6 games, and he had 3 100-yard games, including 92 yards at Tampa and 94 yards versus Seattle, and they brought in Devin Funchess as well. They still have Ted Ginn and Cautery as well, but Kelvin Benjamin is for sure the number one receiver out here. I expect a better season out of Cam Newton, So I'm expecting big things out of Kelvin Benjamin this season, and this could be a steal here, another guy that can be a top 10 wide receiver for you.
Yeah, I don't want to call him a sleeper because he's got the talent to be there. He just hasn't done it because he's only played for 1 year. I think he has a huge year. Funchess on the other side of him, he's another big wide receiver. They're going to put pressure on safeties. They're going to challenge the goal line all the time down in the red zone. Cam Newton is a beast at quarterback, and if he can stand upright, big things for Benjamin.
Number 31, Melvin Gordon from the San Diego Chargers.
We knew they were taking a running back.
Look, 12th running back on the list, so he should be, this should be the last number one running back there is in a 12-team league. Now, this is the rookie out of Wisconsin, picked 15th overall. Ryan Matthews is gone from this team. What they have is Brandon Oliver, Danny Woodhead, and Donald Brown out there behind him. Melvin
Say
Gordon.
What?
Yes, he may not be a traditional feature back. These other guys are going to get some playing time, but this guy is going to get the bulk of the carries, and this guy is a beast. And I see no reason not to take the chance on him here, considering what is after him. I mean, if you want to go with our next guy in Alfred Morris, that's fine, but you know what you're going to get out of that guy. He's not a complete beast. He's a solid running back. I'm going to go with the upside and go Melvin Gordon here.
How come I haven't seen Bishop Kupo Sankey on any of these lists? He was like number 3 in Yahoo last year in running backs.
We're probably only going to do the top 200 by the end of this, so you're not going to hear his name.
We could do the top 1,000 and you wouldn't hear that dude's name. What about the next guy? Another running back.
32, Alfred Morris, running back number 13 on the list from the Washington Redskins. Like I said, he's a guy you can rely on to give you good stats, not great stats. That's why I'm going with the upside of Melvin Gordon before him. But if this is your backup plan, you got a solid number 2 running back here. 1,074 yards rushing last season, 8 rushing touchdowns. But he's not used in the passing game, and mostly because the passing game was completely terrible last season. 17 receptions for 155 yards. He only had one 100-yard rushing game. It was 125 yards at San Fran. But he did come up with 91 yards at Houston, 92 yards at Minnesota, and 96 yards versus Tampa Bay. So he was still somewhat consistent. And he had at least 63 yards rushing 10 times during the season, which is pretty decent. 2 multi-TD games, 18 or more carries 8 times, and his best performance in the passing game, he had 3 catches for 27 yards. So you can see you're not going to get much out of the passing game from him. But their second leading rusher in Roy Helu, he's gone now. They drafted a guy in the 3rd round in rookie Matt Jones, so we'll have to see how much playing time he gets in the end. But Alfred Morris is going to be the number 1 back for sure, so he's still a safe pick here.
RGT3, his quarterback, dropped to, like, RGT8.
Yeah, well, you're not going to hear him in the top 50 here either.
Jesus.
But any kind of improvement out of him should help Alfred Morris a little bit this season. In the end, I think this is a good top-end number 2 running back and a good spot to choose him here late in the 3rd round. And really, he's the last running back that you could trust. And after that, it gets a little bit dicey, man. So what do I have here? I have 13 running backs that I think you can trust going into this season. That's how scary this is going to be for fantasy owners this year.
Beast mode, adding flex players helps.
Number 33, I'm going to go with a tight end here, Jimmy Graham from the Seattle
Jimmy
Seahawks.
Jimmy Cinnamon Graham Cracker.
Look, he had a down season last year. He had some bad games. He still had some good games and ended up with 10 touchdowns and 889 yards. And he came up with 85 receptions too. So he still had a good season. It was still a down year for him. Coming over to a new team where they did not use the tight end much. Luke Wilson led Seattle's tight ends.
Oh, Wilson's brother.
Yeah, you're dead wrong. But 22 receptions for 362 yards from Wilson last season. Their leading tight end. So he's definitely going to be better than Luke Wilson.
He's
no
the best wide
about
receiver on their friggin' team, man.
Yeah, exactly. So he's still going to be used a lot. I just see it got to be not as good. I mean, you might see the same numbers from him this season as he had last season, which are very good numbers, but it's not the usual dominant Jimmy Graham.
Good old Russ Wilson's going to get him the ball.
Yeah, he's going to get him the ball, and that's why I have him as my number 2 tight end here and taking him late in the 3rd round. He's just not that first-round pick anymore or even early 2nd.
He caught half of the amount of touchdowns that Wilson threw last year, so I think he'll at least improve Seattle's offense, even if he's not a great fantasy player.
Oh, he's going to be a good fantasy player, man. Trust me. If you don't get Gronkowski, you're really going to want to draft Jimmy Graham.
Heath Miller all the way.
You're going to want to hope Jimmy Graham falls to the top of the fourth round if you have an early pick, though, because it's scary drafting a tight end that early in a system that doesn't use their tight ends very much and just hoping you get third-round value out of them. Number 34, we're going to stick with the Seattle Seahawks, quarterback Russell Wilson. Now, he only had 3,475 yards passing last year with 20 TDs and 7 picks, but he had 849 yards rushing with 6 rushing touchdowns. He had at least 24 pass attempts in all but 3 games. He had 8 multi-TD games, but he did not have a 3-TD game. He had 4 games with no touchdown passes, 2 300-yard games, 3 100-yard rushing games, though, and including 122 yards versus Washington. So the reason you want to draft Russell Wilson as a top-5 quarterback is because of what he does on the ground. I mean, last season he got a ton of points, 85 points just from rushing yards alone, about.
He doesn't bang his girlfriend, so block him.
Well, if you don't want to draft him, I will be happy if I don't get one of those top 4 quarterbacks. I will be happy if people pass over Russell Wilson thinking he's not the typical fantasy quarterback, because this guy is going to be a big value for someone at this point.
You can have him.
I'll take him. 35th overall, Brandon Cooks, wide receiver from New Orleans. Now, he was a rookie last season. He didn't have a huge year, just 53 receptions on 70 targets, 550 yards and 3 touchdowns, but he only played in 10 games, and he had 5 or more receptions in 7 of those games. He had no 100-yard games, though, although he did come up with 94 yards versus Green Bay, 90 yards versus San Francisco, and 2 of his 3 TDs came over the final 4 games of the season. This guy is definitely the number one receiver out there. They got Marcus Colston. They brought over Ben Watson. They have Josh Hill at tight end as well. Brandon Coleman and Nick Toon they have out there. Brandon Cooks is definitely the number one receiver out there. And whoever the number one receiver is has to be a good fantasy player with Drew Brees at quarterback. Even though they're not going to be as good this season, he's still going to put up fantasy numbers for you.
He's going to cook your fantasy books.
Please believe. Number 36, Lamar Miller, running back from Miami.
Never been a big fan of his.
Yeah, me neither, man. But this is where you're at after the top 12, 13 running backs.
Believe it.
Last season, 1,099 rushing yards, 8 rushing touchdowns. He was used in the passing game somewhat, 38 receptions for 275 yards and a touchdown. He had 2 100-yard rushing games, including 178 versus the Jets in the final game of the season. But he had less than 20 carries in every game, so he's not used that much. He had 12 or less carries 7 times, and he had 2 games with 5 receptions. Still, he's just 24 years old. They have Damian Williams, LaMichael James, and Jay Ajayi out there now behind Miller. So unless Ajayi shows he's as good as everyone hopes he is, them drafting him this year, Miller is going to be the number one back out there. But yeah, you're right. He's not one of those guys you can completely trust. But he's a guy you're going to have to take a chance on if you're looking for a running back here at the top of the fourth round.
I think Miami's offense is full of a bunch of wannabes, and I'm not going to throw Devontae Parker into that yet because he's still a rookie and you haven't seen him. But Tannehill, I'm not sold on him.
How can you say Greg Jennings is a wannabe?
Well, because Greg Jennings is old, dude.
Greg Jennings is someone that's done that.
Yeah, I mean, he's done it, but what's he going to do for you this year? He's a wannabe this year.
He's not a wannabe, though. He's a been there, done that, career's about over. Kenny Stills, I actually like. Look at this receiving core, Rashard Matthews, Greg Jennings, Kenny Stills, Devontae Parker, I mean, that looks pretty decent to me. And plus, he brought in Jordan Cameron at tight end. I kind of like what they got out there. Yeah. It all depends at what they get done at running back, though. Is Ajayi going to step up and be a beast? Or is it going to be Lamar Miller, who, like I said, he's still just 24 years old. So you may see bigger things out of him this season. But they got to get him the ball more, or else he really isn't worth more than this 36th pick overall.
Joe Philbin will screw it up down there in Miami. They'll blow the team up in 2 years.
Number 37, DeAndre Hopkins, wide receiver.
This guy's a beast.
For Houston. Yes,
DeAndre
he is.
Johnson's gone. He could creep up your list. He's another one of those guys that you don't know yet because he was always playing behind somebody.
Yeah, the one thing he has to do this season, though, is he has to find the end zone more. 6 TDs. That's why he's here as something like a fourth-round pick, because he had 76 catches for 1,210 yards last season. That's a big-time stats. Now, he had four 100-yard games, including 238 yards versus Tennessee. He had five or more receptions 10 times, nine or more targets 8 times, and three of his 6 TDs came in the final 4 games of the season. Now, they got rid of Andre Johnson, like you said, and they brought in Cecil Shorts to start opposite of him. So he's definitely the number one receiver out there. They got, what, Brian Hoyer or Ryan Mallett at quarterback, whoever they decide on there. I'm guessing it's going to be Bubby Hoyer here. But DeAndre Hopkins, I really like this guy. He's one of my favorite players in football. He doesn't have the quarterback. That's why he sits here at number 37. If he had the quarterback, he'd be way up the list. But I still expect DeAndre Hopkins to have a big season. He just got to find the end zone a little bit more.
Poor guy's got no quarterback.
Number 38, Justin Forsett of the Baltimore Ravens. Had a big season last year, surprisingly. Now, if you know you're going to get this out of him again this season, he should be a lot higher than 38 on this list. But here's the problem. He turns 30 in October, and he never had more than 619 yards rushing or 4 rushing TDs in a season before last year, going back to 2009, his rookie season. So are you going to get this 1,266 yards and 8 touchdowns? Look, he had 44 receptions for 263 yards last season. 5 100-yard rushing games, 2 multi-TD games on the ground. He had 6 games with 4 or more receptions. He had a huge year. Are you going to trust Justin Forsett at age 30 to somehow turn into this perennial 1,000-yard rusher, though? I'm a little bit scared about that.
The answer is no. I do not trust you, Forsett.
Now, look, he's still one of the top 16, 15 running backs available. But the reason he falls down here in the 4th round or so is because he has nothing to back up last season just besides what he did that year. Although, look, they have Taliaferro and Buck Allen behind him, so he's going to get every chance in the world to be the starting running back. And he is the starting running back, obviously, and he's going to get every chance to be the feature back, I should say. And if he puts up the stats he did last season, this is going to be a steal with this pick, but I'm not trusting it enough to jump up earlier to grab him.
Oh, hell no.
Number 39, Julian Edelman, wide receiver of the New England Patriots.
Brady's favorite target.
Yeah, the reason he falls so far is mostly because Brady is out the first 4 weeks. He should be a little bit higher, too. And this is a good value pick here at number 39 if you can get him. He had 92 catches last year on 135 targets, 972 yards with 4 touchdowns. The reason he's not an elite wide receiver is because he doesn't get those touchdowns. And the reason he falls a little bit more, like I was saying, is because of the Tom Brady suspension. But if you get this guy, when Tom Brady comes back, he should give you excellent value as even a number 2 wide receiver. I mean, he had 6 or more receptions 9 times. He had a 100-yard game versus San Diego with 141 yards. But he had 80 or more yards 8 times last season. So he was pretty consistent when Tom Brady was on his game. And 2 of his 4 touchdowns came in the final 2 games of the season. And he was targeted 65 times over the final 6 games. So it was really later in the season when Tom Brady figured out Julian Edelman is definitely his number one wide receiver over Brandon LaFell. And when Brady comes back, I expect them to be on the same page pretty quickly and Edelman to put up big fantasy points for you. You just got to get through those first 4 weeks. And he should give you something through those first 4 weeks at least.
If he slides down to the 6th round, fans, and you get him 6th, 7th round, you got yourself a steal. Just throw him on your bench for a couple weeks.
Right now I have him about mid 4th round. You want to draft him. So, if you can get him in the 5th, 6th round, you got a steal right there. All right, number 40, Andre Johnson from Indianapolis.
Hey, just because he's 40 years old doesn't mean you got to make him number 40, all right, man? Jeez.
Well, listen, man, I went and looked at a lot of other people's list and seeing where they had guys ranked, and Andre Johnson was a lot lower on this list. I had to move him up a good 20-30 spots from other people because I believe this guy's going to have a good season. Look,
especially with Luck at quarterback.
Look at this. He had 85 catches last year
with nobody at quarterback.
Exactly. 936 yards. Yeah, he didn't find the end zone because he didn't have a quarterback. He's going to find the end zone. He's going to triple those TD numbers this season.
Yeah.
Look, he still had 147 targets last season, and Andrew Luck throws the ball all around the field, so he's going to have a ton of targets. His receptions are going to go up, his yards are going to go up, his touchdowns are going to go up. I understand he's 34 years old, so he's still not the same Andre Johnson he used to be. Still, you don't want to draft him in the first or second round. You can't do that. You can't rely on that, on him enough to do something like that. But listen, as my number two receiver, if I already have my running backs filled out and have a quarterback or something, I am totally happy with Andre Johnson there. Or if he's your number three receiver, even if you already drafted two good wide receivers, I'm pumped. He had 9 or more targets 10 times, 6 or more receptions 9 times. He had a 100-yard game with 134 yards on 10 receptions versus Jacksonville. Plus, he had 99 yards and a touchdown versus Indy. He probably won't have 99 yards versus Indy this season, but 2 of his 3 TDs came in the final 4 games of the season. So you see he started to find the end zone again late in the season. Now, taking over for Reggie Wayne, who had a down season last year, I see no reason this is not an upgrade over Reggie Wayne. This is definitely an upgrade over Reggie Wayne.
Listen, I'm calling 100 catches, 1,200 yards, and 8 touchdowns for Andre Johnson.
Well, then this is a steal of a pick at number 40
I'm
for
telling
you.
I think
you might want to go a little higher
value
with it.
Well, I think you can let him fall. If he's going to keep falling, fans, if nobody's listening to our show, they don't know he's going to be this good. So if you got the inside track and you know what we're saying, let him drop and then get him later. Pick him up as a free agent if you can.
That's what I'm saying. You might be able to find this guy in the 6th or 7th round possibly, and that would be a complete steal. I'm saying this is a very good value pick here at number 40.
Huge potential.
Which is mid-4th round. After him at number 41, we have Jordan Matthews, wide receiver from Philadelphia. Now, you know Jeremy Maclin is gone now out of Philadelphia.
I know this.
So Jordan Matthews is the number one wide receiver out there.
What about that dude's name I can't pronounce?
Nelson Agholor?
Yeah.
He is going to be good, too. Now, I don't have him in my top 50. We might hear him in top 75, though. You'll have to stay tuned to find out, people.
Nice teaser.
Please believe. But look, Jordan Matthews last season, 67 receptions, 872 yards with 8 touchdowns, as pretty much the number 3 wide receiver. He had 3 100-yard games, all within the final 8 games of the season. He had 5 or more receptions 5 times over his last 10 games. He had 6 of his 8 touchdowns over the final 9 games. And like I said, they have Nelson Agholor out there, Miles Austin, and Riley Cooper. Now, you can't trust Agholor to be the number one wide receiver immediately. And if you remember, Jim, Jordan Matthews was a guy I was telling you to pick up last season because I really liked this guy and what he did out of the number 3 wide receiver spot for Philadelphia. Now, I know Nick Foles is gone and Sam Bradford is coming in. I think that's a little bit of a downgrade, but I still think Sam Bradford's going to find ways to get Jordan Matthews the ball because he's the best receiver they got out there.
Weird organization in Philly. I don't even want to try to predict anything. I do agree that Matthews has the best skill set out of those wide receivers. Maybe Nelson Agholor later, but he's still young. I don't know. Riley Cooper's a racist and Miles Austin's washed up, so I don't know what to expect out of these guys.
And plus, DeMarco Murray, he was overused last year, and they bring him in, so we'll have to see what happens.
It's going to be crazy in Philly.
I say the one guy I would trust the most for this Philadelphia team outside of DeMarco Murray, not that I trust him 100%, is Jordan Matthews, though. I do like this guy. Number 42, we got Sammy Watkins from Buffalo, another beast rookie wide receiver last year. Now, he only had 65 receptions, but he had 128 targets, so he pretty much only caught half of his targets, 982 yards on those 65 catches with 6 TDs last season. Now, you know they don't have much of a quarterback, but any kind of improvement at quarterback and improvement in chemistry between Manuel and Watkins is going to give Watkins the chance to have a better season. And you know usually a rookie usually gets better going into his second year.
Right.
So I expect a big uptick in fantasy value from Sammy Watkins this season. And last season, I mean, he showed it in spurts. 4 100-yard games with 157 at the Jets. He had 7 or more receptions 4 times, double-digit targets 5 times. You can see he's the number one receiver out there for sure, although I do like Robert Woods as well, and they brought in Percy Harvin. Still, Sammy Watkins is that guy. And you talk about coming up with big TDs against the Steelers. He came up with 2 TDs in a game that Buffalo won 17-16 versus Minnesota, so he was the only one to find the end zone. So he is the best player on this offense, at least from last season. You got McCoy coming in, so he's probably going to be the guy they feature the most. But Sammy Watkins is a big-time standout wide receiver, and he is going to have a much better season than he had last year coming into his sophomore year. All right, let's move on to number 43 here. I'm going to go with Todd Gurley from St. Louis.
Surprising pick by the Rams.
I like it, though. They really needed a running back. Look, he's participating in training camp, but has been limited to individual drills. I'm trusting this guy to be healthy to start the season. What they have is Trey Mason and Benny Cunningham behind him. Now, is he guaranteed to start immediately? No, probably not. That's why I have him here at number 43, though. But if you look, Mason led the Rams with 765 yards and 4 TD on the ground last season. Pretty decent season for a guy who wasn't the feature back all season long. And Todd Gurley is a much better talent than him. So I see better stats from Gurley than Mason had last season. And if Gurley is any good in the passing game, I could see huge numbers out of him this year. I mean, they brought in Nick Foles to play quarterback for him, which is definitely an upgrade at quarterback for the Rams.
Yes.
And then you look, Cunningham had 45 receptions for him at running back last season. And between Cunningham, Zach Stacy, and Mason, they had 79 receptions. So if Gurley turns into that feature back, you could see a lot of receptions out of this guy. And I really think he is a beast running back in between the tackles. And he's going to have a lot of rushing yards if he gets the chance. And I definitely take the chance on him here at pick 43, which is what, late fourth round? I'm down with it because there isn't much else going on at running back after Todd Gurley here. I mean, there's a couple guys I like that have a chance to have good seasons, but nothing guaranteed. And Gurley has the highest upside out of them all. He just needs to realize it, and I'm taking that chance.
Only thing that scares me is his health. Other than that, I agree with everything you said.
Number 44, one of those guys you might want to take a chance on, and a guy I kind of like coming into this season, Latavius Murray from Oakland. He'll be their starting running back this year. Now, he only had 424 yards last year, but he did it on 82 carries. He had a 5.2 average, which is very nice. Now, he only had 2 rushing touchdowns, but he was used in the passing game somewhat, 17 receptions for 143 yards in limited time. Now, you look, McFadden averaged 3.4 yards per carry for him last year. So when Latavius Murray came in, the offense looked much better with him in the game. So coming into the season, I really think Latavius Murray is going to be worth your number 2 running back pick to fill out your fantasy roster. Now look, he had no more than 4 carries in any of his first 11 games, so he wasn't being used. And he had one 100-yard game on the season, but he only had 4 carries in that game for 112 yards and 2 touchdowns. But he had 68 carries over his final 4 games. He had 4 receptions for 60 yards in the final game of the season. So there's 10 fantasy points right there just in the passing game. This is Derek Carr's second year, so he could show improvement as well. They brought in better wide receivers this season with Amari Cooper and Michael Crabtree. Not that they're dominant, but they're definitely going to show improvement in the passing
game. I've heard a lot of good things about Crabtree coming out of camp, saying that he looks like a man possessed right now. Cooper's got a good chance of being good too, so them on the outside, that'll open up room for Murray. He's really good in space on those screen passes.
Well, then look, you got Trent Richardson and Roy Helu behind him. So, I mean, I sort of like Roy Helu in the passing game, but I'm not trusting him between the tackles, and I'm definitely not trusting Trent Richardson. So Latavius Murray's your guy, and really someone I'm not going to say I completely trust in my fantasy lineup, but he's definitely a guy I'm taking a chance on at this point with all the top running backs gone. And another guy I'll take a chance on is number 45, Frank Gore. Now, I don't think he's going to have a huge season, but I think he is.
I bet you he can crack 1,000 yards.
Yeah, something like he did last year. He had 1,100 yards, a little over 1,100 yards. He had 4 touchdowns. Now, he wasn't used in the passing game at all. That should go up at least a little bit in Indy.
Right.
He had 11 receptions for 111 yards and a touchdown. But he's not the same running back he used to be. And you look, I mean, Indy has had problems in their run game the past few years. Not that
Definitely. It
has hurt them. I mean, they pass a ton. But you look, Trent Richardson led Indy last year with 519 rushing yards and tied Andrew Luck for the team lead with 3 rushing touchdowns. Bradshaw did have 425 yards, though. So between them, they almost had 1,000. But here's the thing. Bradshaw led Indy running backs with 38 receptions. Trent Richardson had 27 receptions. Daniel Heron had 21 receptions. So there's a lot of receptions out there for Frank Gore if he's able to stay in this lineup. Now, he's not going to be a dominant fantasy running back like he used to be. He's going to be okay, and he's going to be a guy that you can keeping your roster from week to week, you just don't expect huge, huge things out of him.
I think as long as he stays healthy, he can easily put up the same numbers last year, especially a couple more touchdowns than he did last year, just because of how many points Indianapolis scores compared to what San Francisco did on offense last year. Kaepernick was terrible last year.
Yeah, please.
So, I think it's really all up to Gore's health. Yeah, he's not going to be 1,500 yards rushing and 800 yards receiving. He'll be a great number three, and if you have to use him as a number two in certain games, I think matchup-wise, he could be a good guy to keep on the roster because they could come up with some good matchups.
Listen, if you're in a 12-team league, man, this is going to be a number two running back for you, and I have no problem with that. I mean, there isn't very good running backs out there. I just want you to temper your expectations because everyone sees Indianapolis, you got a good name in Frank Gore coming over. Everyone thinks huge things out of him. But you just got to remember, Indy didn't get much done on the ground last season. It should be an improvement this year. I just don't want you to think that this guy is going to be a complete monster and a top five running back by any means. Number 46, a guy I really like, Keenan Allen, the 21st wide receiver on my list here from the San Diego Chargers. Now look, he had 77 receptions on 121 targets, just 783 yards and 4 TDs last season. This is a guy last season I said was going to have a huge year, and he really didn't do. But if you look in 2013, his rookie season, he had 71 catches on 105 targets, 1,046 yards and 8 touchdowns. This guy can be a big play guy. And if you look last year, his longest play was just 35 yards. And really, Phillip Rivers showed a little bit of inconsistency last year too and was having trouble getting the ball to his receivers at times.
He's a tool.
But I mean, Keenan Allen, he was targeted 9 or more times in 8 different games. But like I said, inconsistency. 4 less receptions 6 times. He had 3 100-yard games. 135 yards was his season high. And 3 of his 4 TDs, though, came in the final 4 games of the season. So you started to see them get on the same page. I think this guy has all the talent in the world. You look at who else they got. Melvin Floyd, Stevie Johnson, Jacoby Jones. And you still got Antonio Gates, obviously, who's still a pretty decent tight end for you. But Keenan Allen's definitely their best wide receiver out there. I expect much better results this season. And even much better results than he showed his rookie season with a 1,000-yard season and those 8 touchdowns.
A lot of questions in San Diego, whether or not they're going to be moving to L.A. next year. A lot of things circling the team. So I'm hearing a lot of these players really want to go after it. They think they got a team that can contend for the division. And as stupid and annoying as Phillip Rivers is, he's put together some good years. So yeah, they could get together and come up with a good combo. You never know.
Number 47, we're going to go with Golden Tate here, a guy who
Where's J.K. 47? Oh, we're on number 47.
Please believe.
I thought he just got to the studio. I'm sorry.
Detroit wide receiver Golden Tate. Now, this guy had a huge, huge year last year. 99 receptions on 142 targets, 1,331 yards, although he only found the end zone 4 times. Now, he had double-digit targets 8 times, 5 or more receptions in each of his first 9 games, 5 100-yard receiving games, 2 150-yard games, including 154 versus New Orleans for a season high. He had no 100-yard games over the final 7 weeks, though. He had 4 receptions or less in 4 of the last 7 games, and he had only 1 TD over his last 8 games. And really, if Kelvin Johnson comes back healthy this year, Golden Tate is not going to put up those numbers he did last season with the 99 receptions and 1,331 yards, and his TDs were already down. So while he had a huge season last year, I think the targets are going to decrease with the health of Kelvin Johnson coming back. Kelvin Johnson's going to be the guy you want in that offense. While Golden Tate, he's going to be a good receiver for you, but he's not going to have almost 100 catches.
I can see the catches and yards going down a little bit and maybe grabbing 2 to 3 more touchdowns, though.
It's possible for the touchdowns to come up, but like I said,
if Johnson's healthy, Tate's going to be open more. Johnson's going to be getting double teamed. So the opportunities will still be there for Tate. But like you said, the targets just might not be, because we all know how much Stafford loves Calvin Johnson.
Please believe.
I'll throw it to him if he's quadruple covered.
All right, let's move on to number 48 here. Another Detroit line, Joik Bell, their running back. Now, he had 860 rushing yards last season, 7 touchdowns, 34 receptions for 322 yards and a touchdown is pretty decent work out of the passing game. But he had 0 100-yard rushing games, although he did have 91 yards and 2 touchdouns versus Chicago. 5 of his 8 total touchdowns did come in the final 5 games of the season, though. And he had at least 60 yards rushing in each of those final five games as well. So he had a strong final five games of the season. But he also had minor knee and Achilles tendon procedures in January. He worked out on the side with a trainer during Monday's training camp practice. He is expected to be healthy for the beginning of the season, but they also drafted Amir Abdullah in the second round this year. They also have Theo Riddick coming back. So is he going to be the feature back all season? I don't know. It's questionable, but there ain't many good running backs out here. He showed he can get it done at times last season, especially towards the end of the season. He's one of the top 20 running backs still, but I'd be careful because Amir Abdullah could beat him out by season's end.
Reggie Bush is out the door.
Please believe.
Fuck you, Reggie. I don't know. I'm not a huge Joik Bell fan. He's not terrible, but like you said, we're, what, running back 19 now?
Yeah, I mean, still, running back 19, you should still have some good running backs out here. Not that he's terrible or anything. Look at 49 here. It's Jonathan Stewart. Those running backs just aren't very deep this season, and you're going to have to take a chance early in the draft on some of these running backs.
I mean, realistically, you got 24 playing at all given times because you got two for each team in a 12-team league.
And so some even play some in the flex, too, so right, there's even more than 24 most weeks.
Yeah.
And really, Jonathan Stewart, the 20th best running back to have here, 809 yards rushing last season, 3 rushing touchdowns, 25 receptions for 181 yards, and 1 receiving touchdown. Now, he did that in just 13 games, and he did look like a beast at times last season. He had only 175 of the team's 473 carries last season, too, so he didn't get much work. He had 2 100-yard games, including 155 yards at New Orleans. He had 20 or more carries just 3 times, but all within the final 4 games of the season, and both of his 100-yard games came during that span too. So he was running very strong towards the end of the season. And if you look in the playoffs, he had 193 yards and a touchdown in 2 playoff games. D'Angelo Williams is gone. They got Fozzie Whitaker and Cameron Artis Payne. Now Payne could step up and be a decent player for him, but Jonathan Stewart looks like the main guy in his backfield. D'Angelo Williams finally gone. I mean, what Jonathan Stewart showed last season, this guy could have a good season for you, and this could be a nice value pick right here at number 49, or it could also end up being a bust for you. But at this point, you really got to take that chance, because if you haven't filled out your roster with running backs yet, I mean, if you wait past Jonathan Stewart, a couple other guys out there that you're going to hear about in our next segment are Carlos Hyde. You might hear about a T.J. Yeldon from Jacksonville, a Tevin Coleman from Atlanta. Andre Ellington's still out there if you want to trust him, but he's had injury problems. He can't stay on the field. There's Giovanni Bernard out there. I mean, these are guys that are really, really hard to trust. I think
what about LeGarrette Blount? Where is he at?
Yeah, you'll probably hear him in the next segment as well. Are you really going to trust LeGarrette from?
Not at all. I don't trust I don't trust a New England running back just because Belichick never sticks with the same guy.
That's what I'm saying, man. That's why you really have to, I'm not going to say waste a pick on a running back here on Jonathan Stewart. You might have to pass up a name you like at wide receiver or quarterback just to fill out your roster at running back if you don't get some of those running backs early. Now, Jonathan Stewart, he could be a sleeper here at number 49, though. And I kind of like what I see out of him from what I seen last season. And with D'Angelo gone, him being the main back, I kind of like what you get out of him here. I'm just not completely sold on him because we've seen Carolina's run game sputter at times in the past.
Who do we got for our last guy, the 50th best fantasy football prospect?
Well, I'm going to go with Chicago wide receiver Kevin White, the rookie out of West Virginia. He was their first-round pick.
Speed.
Look, Alshon Jeffrey should slot in where Brandon Marshall slot in last year as their number one wide receiver. Although, like I said, you could argue Alshon Jeffrey was the number one wide receiver anyways. But even when they had Marshall and Alshon Jeffrey over the past few years, they both produced very well in the Chicago offense. I'm talking fantasy numbers here, not wins for Chicago, definitely. But you also have Forte in the backfield. I think Kevin White's going to have a good year for him. He should definitely be their number two wide receiver. And Jay Cutler has shown time and time again he can make two wide receivers very valuable in fantasy football.
Please believe, although he's a giant douche, I like Kevin White. I thought White was going to go to the Raiders instead of Cooper. Not that I think White's better. I just thought that the Raiders would be more enamored with his speed. So I was surprised when he stayed. And I think it's a great pick for Chicago in the draft. And I think he's definitely somebody who can put up points just because of his deep speed alone. I mean, look, what did Martavis Bryant get last year? 9 touchdowns?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Just because he can go downfield. So, and I think Kevin White's a little more polished right now than Bryant was, you know, in his first
year. We'll have to see, yeah. I mean, here's the thing, though. If Amari Cooper was drafted by the Chicago Bears, it would be him sitting in this spot, because if Kevin White was with the Oakland Raiders, I wouldn't be as high on him. I just seen Jay Cutler do it before with 2 wide receivers. I see no reason why this highly talented wide receiver out of West Virginia can't step in and produce early on for him.
Put points up.
But that's it. That's our top 50. When we do 51 through 75, you will hear names like DeSean Jackson, possibly, if we find out he stays healthy. Carlos Hyde is still out there. Andre Ellington, who we mentioned.
CJ Spiller. He could have a big year in New Orleans.
Brandon Marshall is another name you might hear. And Vincent Jackson.
What about Toby Gerhart? We're not going to hear his name anytime soon, are we?
You're not going to hear Toby Gerhart anytime soon. Still, like I mentioned Amari Cooper a little bit ago, I don't have him here in the top 50, but you will hear him in the top 100 at least.
Believe it. Well, that wraps up our top 50 countdown for you fans. You guys can follow us on Twitter at @bet_thespread. You can follow me on Twitter at @betjimthewin. Let us know what you think. Check out our Facebook page at facebook.com/betthespread. Keep coming back to the YouTube page. Click subscribe before you exit out of this segment.
Peace.